American Conference on ESPN. From Devlin Fieldhouse in Uptown New Orleans, Louisiana, it's opening night of basketball. Hi, everybody. Tim Grubbs along with former head coach Gino Ford. And tonight, the Tulane Green Wave tip off their season, and they welcome in Alabama A&M. And a lot of excitement as we tip off the start of another basketball season.
Yeah, both teams are going to be really anxious to get the season started. You spend all that time in the fall practicing and beating up on yourselves. Excited to see somebody different across from you tonight.
For Alabama A&M, a team out of the SWAC Conference, Ladarius Tabb. He led the league last year in scoring and rebounds. He leads the way for them.
He does. He was the preseason player of the year in the SWAC, is a big-time offensive rebounder, had nearly 100 offensive rebounds playing on the perimeter last year, which would be as much as you'd see for anyone in the country. Be key Tulane can keep him under control.
For the Tulane Green Wave, it's a different team. They've got seven newcomers, but Lewis Dabney returns 3 points away from 1,000.
Yeah, he'll be excited. The key, you know, can he control the emotion of that? Because that can get in your head. He spent a whole year, everybody telling him how close he is. Great player. All-conference performer, 14 a night. He's going to be the key for the, you know, Tulane tonight, just to get off to a good start with a lot of new faces.
Take a look at the lineups for this evening's ball game. For Alabama A&M, Rakia Battle, Rayshon Green, Christopher Thomas, and then who we talked about in the open, Ladarius Tabb, and let's not forget about Nick West. He's pretty impressive as well. Meanwhile, for Tulane, a lot of newcomers. Started off with the senior guard, Lewis Dabney. Malik Morgan, he's electric, transfer from LSU. Melvin Frazier, a freshman, Dylan Osetkowski, and then the Gernard Giroux, the graduate that came over from Washington, adds a little experience to a Tulane team that is a lot different from a year ago. And Gino, a little bit different as there's head coach Ed Conroy, even 500 in his fifth season here uptown at Tulane.
Well, yeah, I think Tulane's headed in a great direction. They've had a great recruiting class. They've got really good young players. But they're running into this season with all these new faces that need to blend together and get used to one another on the floor, as we know basketball is such a rhythm game.
Meanwhile, for Alabama A&M, the Bulldogs, Willie Hayes in his fifth season. He wants his team just to run.
Yeah, they were out in practice today getting up and down the floor, and they'll be excited to play, and nothing to lose mentality when you come into these games as the team from the smaller conference on the road. Typically these guarantee games, home teams across the country win 72% of the games, and in these non-league games that number is even higher.
These two teams did meet each other a few years back, second ever meeting. Tulane won that ball game back in 2011, 72-63, A&M five returning starters. Meanwhile, Tulane just two, and as we mentioned in the open, Lewis Dabney, 3 points shy of 1,000 in his illustrious career here. Frazier, the freshman, tips it into the backcourt, and it's into the hands of the transfer from LSU, Malik Morgan.
Yeah, now Alabama A&M showing 2-3 zone early in the year. Probably smart because you haven't had a lot of chances for offense against zone. Nice little pass in the post there.
Osetkowski, second effort, not going to happen. Ball went out of bounds off of Giroux, and it goes to Alabama A&M.
Overall, good possession. Didn't score, but got good shot and got an offensive rebound put back. They need to get those, take their time, and get them in.
For A&M, the run by Rakia Battle. Crafts and quick point guard brings it up the floor, and right there, and we mentioned Nick West.
Yeah, Nick West can score, and he's got touch on the perimeter. You saw there, good ball skills, put it on the deck and got it to the rim and made a reverse layup. Not a lot of 6'9 guys showing that.
That was pretty talented. We knew he was pretty good.
Yeah, he can make shots. He's more comfortable facing up. You know, he's not a back-to-the-basket guy, so they don't have a ton of size, so this zone's probably meant to protect him from foul trouble so they don't have to go too deep in the bench.
Fantastic ball movement by Tulane. Dabney had the open three, and it rimmed out.
Close to 1,000th right there.
So they'll slow it down as Battle brings it up the floor. Rakia Battle with 15 on the shot clock. We'll talk about that in a moment. Here's an open three. It's a little short. Second effort, nice offensive rebound by West.
Yeah, they can't afford to give up second shots to Alabama A&M because from a size standpoint, I just don't think the depth is there up front with Alabama A&M at the same level it is with Tulane's bigs. And, you know, when you get those second chances, you're just going to score way more often.
Set to inbound it in is Rayshon Green. Gets it in for Battle. Battle works it around now for Christopher Thomas. A&M in the maroon, Tulane wearing their home whites.
Good pace to the game for A&M. Got him zoned, got him slowed down on one end and being pretty methodical right here.
West, baseline drive, and a nice ball handling along the line, lays it up and in.
And you saw another face-up, put it on the deck and go score. Not the traditional back-you-down jump hook game. Going to drive it, and that was another good move. They'll have to make that adjustment, which they will, but you don't see a lot of guys that size with that type of footwork in game.
Good ball movement there, and Osetkowski slams it home.
Great start right there to get on the board. They got the ball in the high post, which they did in that first possession, missed the layup. If they keep having possessions like that against the zone, it may force Alabama A&M to show some man.
We mentioned here the shot clock a little shorter now, one of the rule changes, which we'll touch on. But this is an A&M team. They don't intend for that to come into matter. They don't let that ball get into single digits all that often.
No, they. You know, right here, you see Tulane showing a little zone. So both coaches early in the year trying to make the other team adjust because you just haven't seen a lot. And with new guards with Tulane, you know, hopefully they can just kind of keep some poise about them and continue to get that ball in the high post against this 2-3 zone, which A&M appears to want to play.
Misconnected on the pass. It went out of bounds. So Tulane with a chance to tie here. Down by a bucket. Morgan atop after the pick by Frazier. Cross-court pass also dangerous, but works to the goal, and the shot by Jerome no good. And here comes A&M off the miss.
West blocked a shot a game a year ago, and that was his size and length right there impacted the possession.
Turned it over. Battle. Took just too many steps underneath there.
Yeah, right idea, but, you know, you get in the lane and get a little happy feet, and Kyle Ingram with the good call right there on a travel.
Yeah, he had the opening there, and maybe those big eyes opened up and said, I got an open look.
Yeah, he did until he saw a 6'10 guy coming over to block it. Not so open at that point.
Giroux underneath, not going to go. Ball gets knocked out of there. One and done there for Tulane. Running the floor here. Tab misfires on the three. Here comes Tulane. Malik Morgan. Nice look to Dabney. Couldn't get it. Osetkowski trying to send it in. And here comes the break.
Yeah, you know, the whole game. How many times does that happen where you miss an easy opportunity at one end and it translates to an easy basket the other way? I have no idea why that is, but you watch college basketball, NBA basketball, that always happens.
Thomas with the bucket. He's a transfer from Snead State. This one saved by Osetkowski, but it's out of bounds.
You're just seeing nerves right now. That's not a bad shot. Frazier's a good shooter. It's in rhythm. The ball's getting to the right places in that high post. But, you know, you just get a lot of new guys that are excited to play. And you need to just settle in a little bit. And I think as the game goes, they'll make some more shots. But right now, A&M's got the game in the right direction on that end of the floor. Tulane's doing some thinking and missing some ones they need to make.
I think these teams, there's so much energy in the building. It's the first time these teams, other than scrimmages and exhibition games, that this is real.
Listen, there's cotton mouth going for 10 guys right now. Nobody can breathe because you're just so excited to get out there and you play hard. And, you know, this thing will settle down as the course of the game wears on. You got to give A&M some credit, but you got A&M's got eight seniors. And that's why they come out and got off to a better start.
So we've got a timeout on the floor. A&M turns it over. The Green Wave trailing here, the Bulldogs early, 6-2 as Osetkowski sends it home.
Coke for your continued support.
Oh.
The Green Wave women's basketball team takes on Jackson State on Tuesday, November 17th.
Tulane, one for their first nine here in the early going. The Green Wave trailing it by the score of 6-2. Mentioned the shot clock shortened to 30, but there's some other key rule changes as well.
There really are. I tell you, this reduced timeouts 5-4 is going to impact teams' strategies in the second half because you don't have that extra timeout in your pocket in close games. They've eliminated the officials' ability to chicken out with that basket good and charge call. So now if they call a charge, the basket's wiped entirely. No five-second call for closely guarded, so you can dribble out the entire shot clock, one player, and then the flopping rule that the NBA has in as well where, you know, they can assess a technical.
You know, for one offseason, that's a whole lot of change to this sport.
I think it's a ton. I mean, it's a lot of substantive changes coming into this young season. That's for sure. And here you're seeing the zone again by A&M that they've had success with.
Dabney over to Morgan. Working the perimeter here. We mentioned Tulane has struggled shooting early but has had some open shots. That one misses, but Dabney with the long rebound.
I think you'll start to see some more dribble penetration, but you just got a kick there. That's a great look for Dabney. I mean, he shot 37% three-point shooter a year ago, an all-conference player. He'll knock that down. Probably, you know, you get that 1,000-point thing in your head. It's hard sometimes to come out and hit that first basket.
Tulane team that a year ago hit a lot of threes. That was a team they loved it from beyond the arc. Here's Battle. Works it underneath. Shot from the corner. Little long. No good. Taken by West. Here comes Morgan pushing it up the floor.
It'd be good if they could get a transition basket to kind of break the ice a little bit. They had the one and they missed a layup. They missed another layup and another offensive rebound. I mean, you can't get a better shot than that. I don't know what Coach Conroy could draw up better than a layup or a dunk attempt. You can't get closer than 1 inch, so we just got to get it in.
Frazier and Giroux both had opportunities there. There's today's officials, John St. Clair, Kyle Ingram, and Ray Acosta making the calls here tonight. Giroux, guy that had four seasons in Washington in the Pac-12, graduated in June and able to come over here to Tulane.
Yeah, got to come back home. And, you know, sometimes when you come back home and you're playing in front of your family for the first time in a long time, it can put a little extra added pressure on you just with tickets and off-the-floor distractions. I kind of have a feeling that once Tulane gets a couple baskets, they're going to go on a run right here, and it's going to happen. But A&M, you got to give them a lot of credit. They've come out in the zone. They've muddied the game up on that end of the floor, not giving Tulane a bunch of easy chances. And when they've had them, they haven't finished.
Well, Giroux, who missed his junior season with a medical redshirt with a torn ACL.
Getting our first look at Perry here, the guard for A&M with the headband, who's up top. Kind of an instant offense guy for them. Coach is really excited, hoping he can be the third piece to go along with their two first-team all-league guys, Tab and West.
He was a transfer from Shelton State Community College. Turns it over, and here comes Frazier, the freshman. Tries to get it in there, and they couldn't finish. Whistle.
He kind of tried to avoid contact right there and slither through two guys. And when you see this one here, he swoops it up. And if he could just land on balance and go up off two and go strong, he probably gets an and one, something the freshman will learn. He's really talented. I know he's off to not a great start, probably not what he wants, but he's going to be a really, really good player here at Tulane.
Huge recruit by Tulane. This is the most local kids on this Tulane team that they've had on this club since back in the Perry Hill days.
Yeah, and I think this is, I'll tell you what, their freshman class is fantastic. Their sophomore class is good, and they've signed three really good players. Another good look for Frazier. Just need to get one in the basket here for him. It's hard when it's not going in. It can get contagious.
A&M by three, 6 minutes into this one. There's Battle, the junior.
Good move there, good penetration and kick, and I think he'll be looking to get this up. Nice pass.
There's Perry underneath, loose ball, and ball went out of bounds, and it'll go back to Tulane.
You can kind of tell that when Perry's in there, he's trying to make some things happen, and it gives him a different type of guard for A&M. He's kind of an instant offense guy. He puts his head down and gets in there amongst the trees, and if he makes a little better pass, I think the freshman Sharif gets an easy dunk right there for him.
Frazier out, Kane Harris in for Tulane. The Green Wave have missed on their last 10 field goal opportunities.
I'm going to tell you, Kane Harris is a Chicago kid and can really, really score. He's an elite scorer offensively. He may be able to get him on track here a little bit.
Good Morgan.
Thought he might have got fouled there, but no call officials thinking he initiated the contact.
Here's A&M running the floor here. Loose ball, and Dabney saves it from going out. He's got Osetkowski, but takes it himself.
Hey,
Lewis Dabney with the bucket.
Third transition and the first time we finished one. you know, Tulane has got to be thinking that. I mean, they go down and get an easy one. They've had three runouts. It's the first one they've finished. And you look here at Dabney, great alert play. Watch him go strong and then go off 2 feet in traffic and finish it, unlike the freshman's play where he's trying to avoid contact in traffic.
And nice play by Osetkowski. When he laid off, the defense didn't know what was going to happen there.
Osetkowski's really a key for this Tulane team. He's got a hugely high basketball IQ. He knows the game. He's a great passer. Now you're seeing Tulane with 1-3-1 zone. Both teams throwing a lot at the opponent here early in the season.
Works it around here. Of course, you mentioned early in the season, you know, these tapes are going to go to all the future opponents here in the next. This is just throwing everybody off a little bit as the season progresses.
Yeah, they'll give them a lot to think about. And there, you know, shot clock's down, and there you see the five-second difference in the shot clock. Didn't have a ton going. The zone slowed them down. And coaches across the country are probably going to play some more zone because that's five less seconds you have to defend with this shot clock going from 35 to 30. Perry gets tough with the ball in a tough spot and dribbles it in and has no chance on that play.
Bringing it up the floor here. Into the hands of Osetkowski. A nice pass there for Dabney, and the shot is long. Loose ball, and in the right place at the right time is Kane Harris.
Yeah, good. Another good look for Dabney. Just, you know, this is a good shooting team, and it's just one of those deals when they start not going early, you can get mental. But I think they'll get that thing turned around. It's a long game, a long season. Great high post. Good pass by Osetkowski. Yeah, I got two hands in the post right there. They've changed the rule in the post. They had that armbar rule where you weren't allowed to put an armbar on, and it was an automatic foul. And now you can, as long as it's 50-50, meaning you're not displacing the opponent, but you can never have two hands on, which is what you saw there in the post.
Ryan Smith checked in a moment ago, so that's who the foul went. Well, actually, wasn't against. That's who induced the foul. Here comes A&M after the miss. Running the floor, as we said they like to do. Osetkowski with the steal.
Need to convert these. I mean, just can't be 1-for-3 on turnovers in secondary. There's Harris.
Shot for three, no good. And here comes Alabama A&M. Back and forth we go.
Might need to open some windows or close them at that end. I don't know. We're getting some good shots for Tulane that aren't going in. A&M's got some good looks as well that haven't quite gone, but good screen on the baseline.
Shot from the corner, no good. Dabney there. Bulldogs lead it by a point. Puts it inside here for Osetkowski. Looks for Ryan Smith. Smith nearly lost it. Here's Dabney. Trying to get that 1,000-point shot, no good.
But there's a penetration from the top that we were talking about earlier against the zone. They're going to need to start driving it. They're doing a lot of great job passing it in the high post, but I think they can get those guards driving in, or they may get some fouls and some other easy opportunities.
So we got a timeout on the floor. Lewis Dabney running the floor. Tulane down by a point. Alabama A&M leading Tulane here with 11:17 remaining in the first half by a point. 6-5, Tulane 1-for-14 from the floor, and Alabama A&M has committed 7 early turnovers.
Yeah, it hasn't been the prettiest start to the season, but totally understandable from Tulane's standpoint, in my opinion, when you've got this many new faces. And, you know, fans sometimes get frustrated early in the year, but it's early, and, you know, you got 32 games to play. The first 8 minutes are pretty irrelevant, but they need to play a little better, and they will.
You know, I thought A&M, you know, with 9 seniors on this club, 7 juniors, a team that returned all 5 starters from a year ago, might have been a little cleaner here in the early goal.
Yeah, I almost think Coach Hayes may be a little disappointed just because they have really controlled the play, aided by some missed opportunities by Tulane, and yet you only have a 1-point lead. I mean, if they were playing well, they might be able to be up 8 or 10, and they've done a great job at this end.
Shot from the corner, no good. Rebound pulled down by Matthew Cotton. Back the other way, and the shot is no good. Sharif has missed a lot of practice time with an injury, but he's back and expected to play quite a few minutes here tonight.
Yeah, I think, you know, when West is out, coach has got to go with them because they don't have a bunch of size. They've only got 2 big bodies, and he's going to have to play quite a few minutes on the year. Give the kid credit for playing a little bit banged up.
Von Julian, another one of those outstanding young freshmen with the miss from three-point land.
I tell you what's key right now. You got to embrace the struggle if you're Tulane, because defensively you got to get stops, because this Alabama A&M team came to play on the defensive end, and their zone has been very good.
Shot for 3, and it is good. So a big 3 from the outside for B.J. Houston.
Another senior comes in off the bench, hits a big shot for him, gets him a little bit of a cushion, and, you know, you always like to have the lead more than one possession.
Jerome works it underneath, and there was a lot of physical contact, but he traveled, took some steps.
He did. You know, Osadkowski's got great patience in the high post. He's so good in there, being able to catch it and play at his own pace and make some decisions. And Giroux will be able to give him that, too, as the year goes on, but that was not a great play there. Here you see the 3 in the corner on great ball reversal. In rhythm, the pass was in the shooting pocket, which is really key, and coaches always emphasize it's a small thing, but hitting each other in the numbers leading to a shot's important.
Houston played 28 games a year ago for Alabama A&M. Bring it across midcourt here. They've used quite a few players here in the early going as Alabama A&M. They've already gone 10 deep in this ballgame.
This is a big zone right now with Frazier on the wing and Morgan up top, who's got good size, and they got Giroux out in the corner right here at 6'9 and got arms forever. So another deflection. I mean, they're going to be able to get some turnovers because that zone is so long. But here's where they've got to convert. You know, you get the turnover. They haven't scored on any of these.
Frazier looks underneath. Shot no good for Ryan Smith, but a foul.
I think right now Coach Conroy is trying to figure out how he can draw up plays to get better than 1 foot, because, I mean, I don't know. They're running really good stuff. I like what they're doing. And, you just keep waiting on it to kind of kick in. But there's a play that probably should be a 3-point play that Smith would probably convert to a 3-point play 9 times out of 10. He steps up, makes the free throw. He needs to make this one, too.
Smith, 27 starts a year ago, came off the bench here today. Converts both.
Good touch right there. Both free throws look good. Got a good release and good follow through. Little token press right here, just trying to, you know, shorten this shot clock. Really, the press back to zone with the new shot clock, like right now it's at 19 seconds, which is a big difference from 24. And you're seeing some more zone right here, and I think they're going to stick with this because both teams are defending so well that there's no reason to get out of what you're doing on defense, but whatever team can kind of break through offensively could get some separation.
Yeah, shot clock was running down there, 4 on the clock. That was a long 3.
Yes, my man Steph Curry's draining that, but there aren't too many other guys hitting that one. A good shot, but Wade is capable shooter, but, you know, NBA threes with hands in your face are not going to be high percentage for anybody.
Yeah, it looked like it was more of a desperation. I don't want this clock to expire on me.
Yeah, well, actually, some guys get excited right there because they got the ball and the shot clock's down. I shoot this. Coach can't get mad if I miss because the shot clock's at 4. I get to jack this one.
So Osadkowski returns, heading back to the bench is Giroux.
Little token man press here, but they're going to fall back in the zone. Of course they are. I mean, you've held them to 7 points in 11 minutes. You're not going to outthink yourself right now. And give Coach Hayes credit for getting them off balance. Try to duck in, drop off there. Didn't work.
Tulane got back defensively. Cotton underneath. Shot no good. Follow up And a loose ball, and it is going to go back to Tulane as he stepped on the baseline.
Yeah, I mean, an A&M, great effort. Got it to the rim, missed. Got the offensive rebound tip. It didn't go. Both teams just kind of laboring offensively right now. And, we're more than halfway through the first half. Somebody needs to get a little rhythm and flow to the offense. Hard when both teams are playing all zone, though. It just sucks the life out of the game. It does, because kids are used to man. And both teams, you know, Tulane's predominantly a man team. So that's what they practice against every day. Good drive here by Dabney.
Dabney couldn't get it to go. It was in the goal. It was in the cylinder, and it popped back out.
It's just been one of those halves, man. Like, I don't know. That's a great move right here. Hesitation off 2 feet. Goes up in traffic on balance. It's half down. And then you get, you know, a shove in the back, which is really unfortunate because you got two Tulane guys about to grab the offensive rebound. And you nudge them in the back. And instead of getting that easy putback, you end up with an offensive foul.
Tulane 2-for-21 shooting here. Yeah, A&M not much better at 4-for-13.
Yeah, there's been a lot of misses so far. The difference is that Tulane's not turned it over, and they keep getting shots. A&M's maybe had some turnovers issues, but both teams in terms of shooting, you know, nowhere near what you would want or hope for.
So battle up top of the key.
Some more 1-3-1 zone right here. Not quite as big with this lineup, Tulane, but got good length. Short corner jumper there. That's a good shot. They're going to have to find him because Houston has now made two. And that, for this game, makes him the hottest guy in the building by a mile. So they better find out where he is and not give him another one.
DJ Houston, here's a steal taken by Tab. Haven't said his name much. He was the guy that is a preseason SWAC player of the year.
Yep, absolutely, but he hasn't really got cooking yet, and they're going to need him to if they're going to pull an upset.
So we got a timeout on the floor. A&M leading Tulane by four, 7:28 to go. Alabama A&M out front, 7:28 to go. First half action leading Tulane by four. Both teams struggling, especially the Green Wave, 0-for-8 from three-point land.
Yeah, that's not going to get it done, obviously. And, you know, some missed layups that have probably been as big a problem as anything. And right now, you know what, B.J. Houston's come in as a senior off the bench and drilled two jumpers. Interesting here, Tulane comes out man-to-man because and it's because Houston's hit the three and then he got the baseline jumper. So now we're going to go man by Tulane, and we'll see if that changes the flow a little bit.
Battle dribbles into the corner. Working it back underneath. We mentioned Tab has not done a lot, but West had some early success. And so has Sharif, a guy that's got a lot of size at 6'8", 230.
He does, and, you know, he's got really good footwork. I watched him today in shoot-around. Coaches were really working with him on his feet. This kid's going to be an excellent player. But, you know, I'm sure Coach Conroy's a little disappointed. He's got some veteran big guys in terms of years' experience. When you get backed down by a freshman and you foul him, you know, that's not a great thing for your defense because you want to keep the freshman under control. control, and he gets, you know, the back of the rim kind roll. He's the first guy to get a roll tonight, Giroux needs to make sure that he doesn't bail him out by fouling. I think if he walls up and makes the freshman finish over length, it's probably a tougher finish for him.
So here is the freshman out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Second free throw, a little long, no good. Rebound, Dabney.
Another little secondary transition here, and A&M just does a great job getting back, getting that zone set up. And, you know, Tulane's kind of searching right now offensively.
Morgan into the corner for Frazier. Shot, actually, see, pass got deflected, and here comes A&M, and there's a foul down the floor.
Well, I think we found Mr. Tab, because
yes,
he's got some springs, man. That thing was dropped off, and if you didn't foul him right here, you were going to make the poster. A really good effort to challenge the play. I'm going to tell you what, it's a good thing that it was Morgan back and coming across there, because he's big and strong and athletic enough to foul him without it being a flagrant foul, without it turning into a three-point play. It was a really good foul, but, I mean, Tab got that thing to the rim in a hurry. We guess we were looking for him, and he just made sure everybody knew he was here with that. That was impressive.
18 points a game, 8 rebounds a year ago for Ladarius Tab as he converts, and Alabama A&M has doubled up Tulane by 7.
Yeah, Tulane right here, you know, this is where you need kind of your veteran guys. You need Dabney right now to get a little bit of a hot hand. You need Osiatowski right now to get something going in the post. You know, somebody that's been here and been around. Frazier's really going to be good, but be nice if somebody else could kind of start it off.
There's a shot from the top of the key. No good by Morgan.
Good rebound there by Smith. Just sealed him and got that long rebound to the corner. Good ball reversal. There you go.
Good shot. Dabney with a good look. Couldn't get it to fall.
Yeah, good look. Not going to get a better look than that. That's wide open in rhythm. Second shot, great effort.
So here comes battle down the floor. Tulane's missing 2 starters due to injury. Cameron Reynolds and Kajon Mack. So a team with all this turnover struggles when you lose 2 guys like that.
It's a great point. And not only is it a problem because there are 2 guys that were starting for them, but it happened within the last 2 weeks. So you go through the whole preseason running offense and having these guys, you know, that you're counting on, and all of a sudden you get them taken away from you. And I'm going to tell you, Cameron Reynolds is versatile and talented offensively as anybody in this conference. And this is a great league. I mean, he can really shoot the ball. He's big, and he'll give them some great punch. And right now they need some offensive punch.
So a timeout used here. Now for Reynolds, he won't be out very long. I think another 2 weeks or so, as he was practicing a little bit today.
Yeah, and you know what? He was taking shots in practice one-handed, and he was able to make them. But, you know, that when you come off a hand surgery, they've got to be careful with them, because if you come back too soon and that bone's not ready, all of a sudden, man, you're down for longer. And clearly, this Tulane team with all these new pieces is going to be much better in December and January than they are going to be in November. And he's a big part of that. And you can't get better when you got guys sitting out on the side because they lose the timing and guys get anxious and you can't even settle into roles. Zone on the under out right here, 2-3.
Tulane exhausted its first time out of the ballgame.
They switched it and went man once they set the first screen. So now we're back man, and we get a little ball screen, perimeter that Tulane did not switch.
Tab with the save and into the hands of Battle.
Got to be happy if you're, you know, both teams defensively. The coaches will be all excited, and, you know, you go in, you just keep telling guys, take the same shots. We're getting the shots we want. That's great defense by Frazier. Really good discipline for a freshman.
2 seconds on the shot clock. Battle just kind of heaved it up. Here comes Morgan bringing it up the floor. Morgan runs the floor and lays it up and in.
Some penetration and a made layup. Feels like a touchdown.
Shot for 3, and he buries it.
Just not matched up, and that's an inexperienced play. You know, not finding guys. A.J. Wade, another senior for this A&M team that's shown some really good poise. That's a huge shot right there, because Tulane got a little momentum finally, and then you just get it zapped away from you.
And, you know, you got guys like Wade and Houston, didn't score a whole lot last year, but got some minutes. They're contributing a lot here. Wide open, Ryan Smith.
Yeah, Malik Morgan's made 2 great plays in a row. That's a terrific ball fake pass. Ryan Smith is smart player, right place, right time, good catch and finish on a night where catching and finishing has not been the norm, unfortunately.
Rolls right.
Going to hedge the sideline ball screen and go over, which will force some rotation. That was a great job by Tulane, making him skip it and getting zoned up. Flat ball screen here.
Battle works it over. Drives to the goal, shot no good. Smith looked like he had a chance at the rebound. Couldn't. Tap for three, no good. Pulled down by Osetkowski.
Tulane dodged the bullet there.
Here's Morgan. Good pass here to Harris. Kane Harris.
I'm telling you, Kane Harris can really score now. He's a freshman. He'll have his up and downs as every freshman does, but Kane Harris is a very capable scorer, one of the best players in the state of Illinois and in a great city of Chicago with a lot of great players the last few years.
One of the terrific recruits by this Tulane coaching staff.
Really good defense by Frazier there.
Along the baseline.
You see how quick he is off the floor? He knew he missed it. I mean, that was almost like a pass to himself. Almost a pass to himself and a finish.
Here's a steal. Battle back to Tab.
Boy. Thought he'd get that thing in. That was another good play. Tab is really elite in transition. And his second effort on that miss, he knew he missed it, and he was absolutely back up to tip it in.
3:34 remaining. Physical game, but Alabama A&M running it up by six. Both teams struggling early from the floor. Tulane 20%, A&M 35%.
Yeah, you know, Coach Conroy, I'm sure, is frustrated with the finishing, but the execution has not been that bad. A few turnovers there once I said they hadn't turned it over. I jinxed them on that touch, but overall getting good shots. The difference a little bit has been the rare transitions for Alabama A&M have led to baskets. And the transitions for Tulane not only did not lead to baskets, a couple of them led to baskets going back the other way. Those are four-point swings, and in a game that's 6-7 points right now, late first half, you know, that's the difference between being up and down.
Darius Tab, one of two, Osetkowski with the board.
There's no way there'll be anything but zone for a while here. I mean, Alabama A&M's got to stick with it. Now, this is not a very big zone because they've taken the big guys out, and you're seeing right now playing in the middle of the zone, and that's where they just threw it is Tab. So, really smart offense. I mean, they took both big guys out. You got to go right in there, and these guys got to deliver and give Giroux credit because he got that in. But they can need to throw it in there the next two times until they come back with some of the bigger bodies, you know, with Sharif.
Well, he got it in there, and Giroux showed a little patience there rather than try to force it.
Yeah, and early, you know, the avoiding contact and being in a hurry, that's all nerves.
Good ball movement, three ball, no good. Long rebound pulled down by Julian, and a whistle.
I'm not sure what he called right here. He called a hold on the block out. Those calls as a coach you hate. I mean, it may very well have been a foul, but, you know, those things, that's a transition that you got if you don't have the foul. They may have grabbed them. I mean, I didn't have a great look at it, but those things, you know, those are big calls in games.
Eighth team foul whistled against Tulane.
But I missed, so it doesn't matter.
So
Rasheed Wallace tell you the ball don't lie, I guess.
Zachary Jackson missed it. Von Julian. Freshman point guard, one of the top kids in the state.
Yeah, this thing's got to get inside, either off dribble drive or just jam it down high-low.
Julian works it around. 10 on the shot clock. Works it in for Giroux, but the pass was deflected. A&M with the turnover.
Yeah, that's tough right there. Frazier's had a little bit of a tough start here. Really, it's too bad because he'll hopefully come out of it in the second half. He's going to have a really good year. I watched him the other day in practice. He was the best player on the floor. But some days, you know, it's a different game, man. Different animal. It's not high school.
10 on the shot clock.
A little five-out dribble weave here by A&M to control tempo, and they're in the one-and-one.
Battle with a good look to tap. Couldn't finish.
Yeah, that's bad defense in the corner there. Kane Harris turning his head. This five-out dribble weave, you got to stay engaged off the ball and stay in gaps because there's so much space to play, and you see there slipping in behind Tab, and you don't want to be basing your defense hoping Tab's going to miss layups because he's been a great finisher tonight and certainly through his career.
One man pressuring the freshman, Julian.
Yeah, and they're doing that because what it does is it slows the ball down, and you got the other four guys who are already in the zone. So instead of being able to race it down, great shot by Giroux right there in the high post. We've said with this smaller lineup that A&M's playing with the foul trouble they've got and just trying to get to the half, that thing's got to keep going in the post.
Tulane has had four field goals their last four trips down the floor.
Yeah, and that's why all of a sudden the game looks a whole lot different when the ball's going in the basket. Another dribble drive here. Oh, boy, and one. I don't know if they're going to count that. Probably are.
Looks like they will.
Yeah.
And Zachary Jackson with the bucket.
See, this is what happens. Like, you know, you're talking about A&M small, so Tulane can get it right inside, and then you come down the other end, and it's a mismatch the other way because you all of a sudden have Giroux trying to keep in front of a 6'2" guard, and that's hard for those big guys. You know, Jackson's able to get it there and get an and one, which he missed another free throw, so they got lucky and only gave up two. They got to keep jamming it inside, and they're going to need to figure out help defense assignments down here when they get mismatches with their bigger guys forced to guard littles.
Julian off to Harris. 15 in the shot clock. Julian from three. Rebound pulled down by Giroux, and he gets fouled.
Giroux has controlled the paint offensively the last three trips. Got the inside good post move where he was patient, scored, hit a high post jumper, and now gets a great offensive rebound in traffic, takes a dribble strong, goes up, draws a foul. And he's a good shooter. He's got good touch. He needs to knock his free throws in just to keep the ball going in the basket because you need to keep scoring just for confidence sake. This is a big minute right here. A&M somehow gets this lead to 10. It's got a whole different feel than if Tulane's able to come back in the next minute and tighten it up to two or maybe even tie it because there's going to be three possessions most likely, maybe even a fourth.
With a minute two to go, and Giroux missed both, gets his own rebound and follows.
Hey, that's a great idea. Just run it, miss it, grab it, and lay it in. That was a lot easier than that 15-footer.
The big guy.
Listen, I don't know if Coach Conroy's felt so good about made layup, but tonight that's a cause for celebration. I mean, they've settled down just like we talked about, and they've really done a much better job. Give Giroux credit because he's given them some good life offensively right here. Coach back in the zone with this bigger lineup against all these guards. Got to roll.
Shot from outside. It is good.
Yeah, that's a big shot right there. I mean, getting the roll on a three-pointer, that doesn't happen too often.
It looked like it was going to bounce out, and it got the roll. So all of a sudden, it's a six-point lead.
Yep.
20 seconds to go. Looks like Tulane might be happy for the final shot.
Yeah, I think it looks like that's what they're going to do. And I'm not sure if it looks like A&M's trying to shade them. I mean, whether they're going to go man, which they did. And now you got a flat ball screen. Oh, illegal screen call. Yeah, that's tough because that wiped away a layup, and it was a good call. He ran up. You got to give the guy a step. The rule is you cannot come up and set a back screen on a player with no separation. So if he has to have room to turn and make one natural step, and then you can have the collision. But you can't run right up into the guy and create the collision at the point of the defense.
So it's a six-point advantage, and A&M's got time here with three. Shot no good. Rebound pulled down by Tulane, and two Green Wave players collide.
That's fitting way to end the half right there. I mean, they made a good block out and come up with the ball, and unfortunately two guys run into each other on the way up the floor. It's just was that kind of half.
The percentages we'll talk about in the intermission, but these teams certainly, especially Tulane, missed a lot of opportunities in the first half.
Yeah, you're not going to win the game when you're shooting below 25%. And, you know, they're going to have to figure some way to make some shots.
25-19, Alabama A&M leads at the intermission. No one here. Oh, here she is. She's here. Are we sitting on the we're sitting on the floor, right? Okay.
It's fine. I could just...
Yeah, that's all we get. Mike, you got me? Awesome. Deputy Athletic Director, right?
Yes, got right. it.
Just want to make sure I don't want to ruin anybody's title.
No, you're good. Thank you.
Okay. We're back uptown New Orleans, Devlin Fieldhouse on the campus of Tulane University, where Alabama A&M leads 25-19. Hi, everybody. Tim Grubbs joined here with the Deputy Athletic Director here at Tulane University, Barbara Burke. And Barbara, thank you for taking some time to talk to us. Exciting times here on campus with the beginning of winter sports and a doubleheader here tonight.
It's been a great day. You know, the women got off to a great start tonight. Now the men, they'll get it going here in the second half, I'm confident.
Women's basketball team has been fantastic. Another trip to the NCAA tournament a year ago.
And we're so fortunate to have Lisa Stockton. She's been here over 20 years and such a great mentor for our young women. And the kids really love playing for her. They play hard. It's very evident.
A big transition a year ago, making the jump from Conference USA to the American Athletic Association. And it's done well for especially women's basketball, and men's basketball made a big stride a year ago as well.
It's been amazing. Across the board, all of our sports has benefited from being a member of the American Athletic Conference. We're so proud to be in this league. It does so much for us from a television perspective. You know, 80% of our alums live outside the New Orleans area, so they get to see us consistently, which means a lot to us.
One of the things that you've been working hard over the last few years is making the jump with facilities. First of all, Yeoman Stadium, the football facility opened a year ago, the practice facility for basketball, and this beautiful venue. Man, has it come a long way in 4 or 5 years.
You know, it's been exciting to see the transformation in all of our facilities, again, across the board. We actually just finished renovating our women's basketball locker room. You see behind us a new video board in here that matches what we did at Yeoman Stadium. We're in our second season there, so that's been really exciting. We're just now putting a new video board at Turchin Stadium, home of Tulane baseball. So a lot of things just keep moving, just keep getting better.
It's the little things for fan interaction, things like the video boards, that really help to encourage ticket sales and marketing.
Absolutely. The fan amenities, you know, when folks come, they have expectations, and we're working really hard to meet those expectations.
Barbara, appreciate your time, and continue the success and the great work here at Tulane.
Great. Thank you so much.
Barbara Burke, the Deputy Athletic Director. We got a look around the conference, first half stats, and much more coming up from Devlin Fieldhouse.
All right. Are we on camera? We're just at the beginning and at the end, probably? All right, so we can stare at that.
Tulane here at the intermission, 25-19. Tim Grubbs joined here with Gino Ford. And Gino, an exciting day as basketball season tips off, and a very exciting day for the American Athletic Conference.
Yeah, what a great league. I mean, you know, people talk about the power conferences. This conference is right up there with everyone in the country in terms of RPI, computer ratings, and at-large bids. But that starts with non-league wins. You've got to win in the non-league to build that RPI, to get those fourth and fifth bids, which this league's going to do.
And there's some teams from around the league playing some big-time opponents, including the number one team in the nation, the Tar Heels of North Carolina.
Yeah, Temple, you know, you get beat, but the number one team on the road, that's a tall task, especially early in the year with some new pieces. Cincinnati, always good, Coach Cronin. And, you know, right there, South Florida, a team that's been very much rebuilding. Got a whole new roster coming off a very tough year a year ago, up close at the half with Troy. And UConn's always UConn. You know, it doesn't seem like they have bad basketball teams up there. So hopefully East Carolina gets it turned around for the league. And, you know, if you go through the night with all wins and a loss to the number one team in the country, that's not a bad night.
You'll certainly take that, as you notice that the Connecticut Huskies are ranked again, a team just 1 year away from a national title.
Yeah, and they've got players that can get them right back there. The thing that was amazing, they missed that NCAA tournament for the APR with the academic stuff. They weren't able to get in. Well, they didn't take any time to rebuild. It was a quick reload, and they were right back competing with the top teams in the country, which they've just been able to do on a year-in, year-out basis for a long time.
We'll take another timeout, come back, take a look at this first half with some highlights and some statistics from New Orleans. Alabama A&M leading it by six. He couldn't hear you at all.
I got him. I got you now. Sorry.
Mike, are we? No,
not at all. Actually, once we started, I bumped my elbow, hit the cord, and the earpiece came out just far enough I couldn't hear you at all. So if I screwed up, it was just me.
Okay.
We're over here.
We are at halftime, Devlin Fieldhouse in New Orleans, Alabama A&M, with a slight advantage over Tulane here at halftime, 25-19. Let's take a look at some of the first half highlights. First of all, for Alabama A&M, actually for Tulane, Ryan Smith with a block.
Great, two great effort plays right here by Ryan Smith, preventing two layups, getting his hands on it, and then a nice pass and finish for him when they were able to find him behind that zone.
For Alabama A&M, they drained some trays.
Yeah, B.J. Houston was really the only guy in the building that had a hot hand. Unfortunately, it didn't catch any of the other players much on either team in that half. This halftime segment won't go super long because there just weren't a lot of baskets. A good shot here on a ball reversal gets a great shooter's roll. Another thing, you know, you just didn't see a lot. Both teams competing hard, but you can see the stats. Not going to win when you shoot 0 for 11 from 3. Now, it's a new half, so the Tulane needs to recharge and reboot. Obviously, if you're Alabama A&M, in my opinion, you're pretty happy. You come on the road in a guarantee game that, you know, you're not getting a return out of it. You want to give yourself a chance to compete and win, and all of a sudden they're up 6 at the half in spite of only 3 made threes. It's not like Alabama A&M went bonkers. So, you know, if you're Coach Hayes, I think you're fist pumping a little bit, feeling good about life. I would expect the second half, the first 4 minutes, to be really key.
So it's Alabama A&M leading it by 6. Second half play-by-play coming up next.
You're watching the American Athletic Conference on ESPN. We are set. Second half here. Devlin Fieldhouse for Alabama A&M with a stunning first half, leading it by 6.
Yeah, you know, surprise only because, you know, when you're Tulane in these games, you certainly would expect to win, and I still think there's a lot of basketball yet to be played. Give Alabama A&M a lot of credit. These guys come in the season with all these road games. They play this one on the road, go home for 2, and 8 more road games, so they're used to brutal schedules in November, December.
Yeah, they've got a tough road ahead of themselves. Drives, shot, no good. You mentioned at the half what Coach Hayes would have said at half. What about Coach Conroy? Is a nice pass there for Osetkowski. Back to Giroux and Dylan Osetkowski from 3.
And it rattles out. It's unbelievable. I mean, that thing's half in. It's a great shot, good possession. They've got to convert transition. I would imagine he talked to him quite a bit about finishing because there were so many possessions where they got it where they wanted. They ran what they wanted to run and didn't finish a layup. And there's no solution for that other than taking your time time and going up strong in traffic off 2 feet and getting it in the basket. You make layups with your eyes. You make them with concentration. It's not a physical thing.
Battle. Four on the shot clock. Shot rimmed in and out. No good. Morgan pulls it down, but we got a whistle and a blocking foul.
Yeah, I tell you, this is the third foul we've had on a blockout by Tulane. And sometimes, you know, the physicality of the American Conference, they're used to playing a physical brand of basketball. And, you know, the guy gets knocked down, you're going to get called for a foul. You've got to control your physicality and not foul in that situation, even though you might be 10, 15 pounds heavier than the guy you're guarding.
A&M worked that clock down. Really didn't get a good shot up, and they get the ball right back.
Yeah, that was West traveling. You know, he had had success going right in the first half twice. I thought Giroux did a good job jumping that right, and it led to a jab step crossover move, and he just stepped right and went left and shuffled the feet, and it was a travel.
Here's Malik Morgan. Scored a bucket in the first half.
I think if Frazier could get something, an easy one, an offensive rebound put back or something, you know, in transition, might get him going. You see just the ball's not as crisp. You know, we're dropping passes. If you're Tulane, you've got opportunities to make some things happen. And like Dabney even didn't feel like he was down and ready to shoot that. You're a 37% three-point shooter a year ago. You got to catch that thing in rhythm and let it go. You just got to shoot it.
Slipped right out of his hand. So a block there. Maintained possession. For Tulane. Morgan lobs it in.
Yeah, baseline out of bounds, you know, seeing the zone, you just try to get it in bounds. And they had a good possession early where they ran a little X cut inside. That time they went with something different and had to throw it out long and just kind of have a safety valve. I think Morgan needs to drive this zone from the top. He did it in the first half one time, and he got that basket, if you remember, driving to his left. Those guards for A&M are really wide in the zone. It's preventing quick ball reversal. He needs to put his head down and drive into the high post, make somebody play him, and then make the play.
Morgan was a pretty good player 2 years ago. 52 games in his freshman and sophomore year at LSU. Here's Dabney from the corner, and it's no good.
Well, there was that X-cut play I just talked about. They ran it again. They got another great shot. It just didn't go in. So this thing here comes to the top, and it gets reversed. Dabney's got to unload that. You can't catch and hold it. He's too good, and there's his 1,000th point. You've just got to shoot the ball. He's an unselfish kid. He's a great kid, and he's thinking too much. And now hopefully that 1,000-point thing's over, and his cousins and everybody else been talking to him. Leave him alone. He can play.
Get that monkey off his shoulder.
Yeah, hopefully, you know, he may get hot and go bonkers here in the second half.
Looks it underneath, and the layup is there for Nick West.
Yeah, good high-low, and that's really not good help defense by Frazier. Came across instead of walling up using his body and being physical. He just rode by going for a steal and gave a layup. And see, I think Dabney needs to be down ready to shoot that one. You just made one. It gets passed and kicked back to you. Need to be down and hungry.
Morgan to Frazier, shot long. Giroux couldn't pull it down. It's down, rebounded for Tab.
Yeah, Tab's, you know, kind of quietly just found his way in a nice rhythm to the game. We talked about him early. He was kind of not involved a bunch, but here lately got those couple transition, had the big offensive rebound play. But on the play before, when Dabney had just hit that three for 1,000 point, and he turned down the jumper, probably should have shot it. What it ended up doing, three passes later, Frazier, who's going to be really good, hasn't had a great ball game and ends up with a shot. So instead of Dabney, who just made one, you got a different guy shooting one who hasn't quite had it going yet tonight.
Sent him out for the baseline, and Dabney got a piece of that one. And
good thing he did, because they ran a reverse screen-to-screen action. They had a layup on the weak side. Coach worked on this in practice, where they really emphasized the guy who's guarding the inbounder take away the weak side block, and he did a terrific job there. And now West gets it inside, and that's too easy. He's got good touch and length. He's had a heck of a ball game.
8 points for West. The lead is back to 7. Dabney looking for Osetkowski.
Feel like guys are catching and holding and surveying instead of just making a quick decision with the ball. And there they had another one, you know, get a foul on a blockout, which is actually big, because any foul they can get on West right now, for if you're Tulane, is good, because he's having his way on the other end and, you know, scoring the ball consistently.
It's 3 on West.
Yeah, they can't afford him to get in foul trouble. I mean, Sharif really gave him a nice lift in the first half. He did, you know, but he's a freshman, and West has been a difference maker in this game at this point.
Cross-court pass to Frazier. to Ryan Smith, trying to get a nice pass there and couldn't finish. Another follow-up, and he gets it to
go.
Yeah,
good effort play. You just got to stick with it. These kind of games, I'm telling you, got to embrace the struggle and just find a way if you're Tulane and if you're A&M, you know, your love and life here because you've shortened it to a 16-minute game.
I really like that. Embrace the struggle.
Well, you better embrace it because it's a struggle. Ask anybody here. They'll tell you. Coach knows. Everybody knows. I'm going to tell you, that's a great rule change right there, too. Timeout in the corner. Coaches can't call live ball timeouts. Used to be the coach would have seen that coming. He'd have called timeout right away. You can't anymore. So fortunately for them, it's a senior West makes an alert play for the timeout.
Tulane trailing Alabama A&M. 29-24, 16-10 to go. Second half. New Orleans. Alabama A&M leading Tulane by five here. 29-24.
Tough place to inbound the ball. Deep, deep corner. I wouldn't be surprised Tulane gets all over this in the corner and tries to force a turnover because this is not a lot of room to get it inbounds. Not a place you have a lot of set options here. Now they let them get it in easy.
12 on the shot clock, so they have time here. Green works it into the corner, and that's a big shot from there for West.
Yeah, as we said earlier, he's got a different kind of game for that size. He's a face-up jump shooter and a driver. He's had a great game and hasn't done any of it with posting up and backing guys down. He's got three fouls. If they really need to get, that's a big shot for Dabney.
Dabney for three.
He's the answer for Tulane. He's got to just let it go. I mean, with the times he's caught it and shot it, he's had success. It's a quick shot for A&M. We haven't seen a lot of that.
With the rebound, but a whistle.
That was as fast as this game's been right there. It went up and back. You know, we had a made jumper by West, quick one by Dabney, and a quick shot attempt here. And if you're too late, unfortunately, you don't get the defensive rebound because it could have led to a transition going the other way.
We got another timeout on the floor. It is. They're Tulane trailing here by 5, 32-27.
They just had that 16-minute. Because we just had the timeout.
Yeah,
timeout in the corner.
No, so it's good. Dabney has four. That was on him. Four on him.
Michael.
Wow. That's an enormous foul right there.
Alabama A&M leading it 32-27. Right before we went to the media timeout, Lewis Dabney, who's just started to, I think, get the feel of the game, picked up personal foul number 4.
Well, he's made 2 3-pointers, in the last 4 possessions. And here you see a blockout, and there's a collision, and he gets called for a foul, knocking down West. That is an enormous play in this game, because somebody for Tulane is going to have to step up, because he had just started to get a hot hand, and he's the answer for them because he's the most veteran guy they have. That's a really, really difficult play for Tulane right now, because that's the last guy you want to see in foul trouble.
Yeah, with 15:35 to go, so a whole lot of game ahead of us.
Yeah, that's going to take away any rhythm he had. You know, you're going to sit over there until, probably the 7-8 minute mark minimum. They got to get West under control, and if they're A&M, I'm not shocked that that's where they went. He's going to face up, and good job double-teaming right there and making him give it up. Got a good slide over right there with Morgan.
Yeah, it looks like the offense is running through Nick West here, number 35 in the middle. Battle's just trying to get him open here as he's being manned up by Ryan Smith.
Yeah, double high ball screen, really just trying to get it back to West. That's a tough shot. That's not going. Yeah. That's okay if you're too late. You'll have to take that NBA 3 contested like that, but you don't want him shooting anything else because he's been fantastic.
So here's Morgan, 4-0 Setkowski, and he needs to really just kind of jump it up and spark the offense.
That was a great move, and he caught it and went right away. It looked like he may have taken an extra step, but I like the approach because West has 3 fouls. I mean, you're sitting there, Dabney's got 4 and is removed from you offensively. West has carried the entire load down here, and he's got 3. They got to find a way to get him his 4th foul.
Foro Setkowski's 4th point of the night. Looks it underneath, and the tip-in is there.
Yeah, it's a perfect air ball. Sometimes the hardest shot to rebound defensively is an air ball by the other team because you're going to block out, you're waiting for it to hit the rim, and it just doesn't happen. The timing's different on your jump.
So Morgan.
Good skip pass. I think that's good.
A lot of contact. They let the first one get away, but when he did it the second time, it was like, uh-oh.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and call that one. I'll tell you what, I give the officials a lot of credit because they're constantly under, being watched and monitored and wanting the game cleaned up and more fouls. I'm going to be honest, they've really been a non-factor, which is an official's a great compliment. You know, you don't want to stand out in the game. They haven't impacted the flow. They've just called it. They've done a really nice job.
Alabama A&M by 5. Fresh shot clock here from Tulane from the baseline.
Got to get it in the high post again, and I still am convinced that Morgan can get it off the deck in there. Harris is very capable of that. He's been good. He's made 2. With Dabney out, he has to be a weapon for him offensively, and he's very, very good at that end. That's a quick shot. See, you like that. What are they going to call here? A hold on the blockout. That's the 4th or 5th foul Tulane's had on a blockout. I think it's the 5th. And that's really hard because, again, that's a transition going the other way, and instead you got a holding foul. And right here you see he's got his left arm. It's a good call. He hooked him. He hooked him with his left, and he hooked him with his right. Could have called him twice. Got to show those hands on the blockout.
So instead of a one and done and Tulane on the run, back to A&M.
I can't believe West passed that. What a good play, and he called another foul on a blockout. That's 6 fouls we've had for Tulane on blockout fouls. And we showed the replay last time. They hooked with their arms. You've got to show your hands to those officials under the basket. But, boy, that's an enormous thing because instead of 34-32 Tulane transition, it's 36-32 and the ball's still down at this end of the floor. That's 2 trips in a row. I mean, right here they get Morgan inside. Called him hooking, I guess, with that right arm. I don't know. That's probably a little tougher than the other one.
So it's a 4-point advantage. Battle. Back out to Nick West. Looked underneath. Pass sailed a little high.
You know, Tulane, I honestly believe this. If you're them, I think you're happy because the pace of the game is sped up. And it's gotten a little chippy, which sometimes gets you out of thinking because part of their problem was they were mentally bogged down that first half. And now things have gotten chippy. A couple close calls maybe didn't go your way. A couple physical plays. Maybe you can just get in the flow of the game and get competing and stop thinking about the ref, missing shots.
Nice recovery by Morgan, but that nearly threw it away. And here comes A&M back the other way. Battle. He'll pull up from 12. A little long. ball bounces up and out, and that'll go back to Tulane.
Yeah, that's a fortunate defensive trip right there. They didn't quite get matched up in conversion and got a good look, and that's something Tulane really works hard on, is getting back in transition. They're excellent at that. Typically, that was way too good of a look on a secondary break.
So Julian, the freshman, trying to spark the offense here.
Yeah, coach is searching. There's a big shot.
Oh, Sitkowski.
He's made two, and, you know, you made the point. He probably needs to be a little more aggressive. Don't catch it, hold it, survey what you're going to do. Just react.
Good
deep, deep post up. It's, you know, this game has been so many times where Tulane has made that play offensively where you think, oh, they're going to get sparked, and they haven't taken it to the defensive end and got a stop. They've had that play offensively, and then every time it's happened, they've had a big offensive possession, it's been a basket at the other end. And it just, you know, they haven't been able to turn the game yet with that. If they could maybe tie an offense with a defense together, it would help them, but their timing has been horrendous for defensive lapses.
I was about to say a moment ago, Dylan Osetkowski, a guy that's 6'8", a sophomore, I think took three three-pointers last year.
Well, the way he shot that one, and he had the one rattle out earlier, he probably, you know, needs to continue to shoot them because they look good, and he's a real threat in the high post, and it should open up a little high-low because now West 35's coming much higher in this zone up to the foul line to guard him, and they may be able to get high-low.
Jumper for three. Buried it.
Yeah, Kane Harris can do that now. I mean, that's three tonight. He's instant offense. You know, we talked about that earlier, and unfortunately, there we go again with great play offensively, come down and they weren't matched up. It wasn't anything tricky. They just did not get matched up on conversion. And you give a guy who's a conference player of the year in the SWAC, Tab, an and one when he doesn't have to do anything. He just has to catch it and turn and lay it in.
Tulane had just tied the ball game for the first time tonight.
But you could tell it was like they've just had a hard time flipping it. They haven't strung it together. And I'm telling you, that is called being young and being new. They've got talent. They got players. They got some guys out. They're going to be better and better. He can hit another one.
He's got the hot hand.
He's right now igniting all the offense, hitting a three, and then he didn't know who he was guarding and gave up a three-point play, and he hit another three. He's creating it on both ends. Going to have to, as a freshman, figure out this end of the floor. But down there, he knows what he's doing.
Tries to answer, a three ball is short by A.J. Wade, who had a big one earlier.
First time all game where a good offensive possession with a big shot comes back to defense and they contested a shot. Kane Harris has just been on fire. Third three, drills it in the corner, and you see him celebrate and running it down the other way, and the bench is into it.
Okay. Gotcha. Lewis Dabney seemed to be lighting it up. He went down with his fourth foul. They needed someone to step it up. Kane Harris with three threes.
He brought some offense from Chicago, my man. He can really score. He's got great footwork. Here you're seeing him with three straight threes, but the consistent footwork And the approach mentally, when he caught the ball, there was no doubt. Even in the first half, when he missed a couple and then he hit that little mid-range shot, he has had an approach of when I'm open and I'm in rhythm, I'm going to let it go and shoot it. And that's been different than some of the other mental approaches for some of the other guys. Kane's got a lot of confidence as an offensive guy. We talked about him when he first came in, and he was very capable of doing this. And with Dabney out, I mean, he's barely come to the rescue.
I mentioned it earlier. This is a Tulane team that loved the threes a year ago. Attempted 199 of them. That was the fourth most in school history.
They've taken 20 already tonight. Going to see in zone. Ostertowski, what a great pass. Really, really good in the high post. Straight line drive right down the lane. Made the guy commit. Shoveled it for an easy two.
First time tonight, Tulane has the lead.
Looking to throw it inside against Harris, and great help side by Giroux, gets a piece of it. The total tempo of the game has changed, but right here, it's a freshman play. Guys chasing you behind, and you don't see them, and then turn it over.
There's Ted,
and he is terrific at that. He is not missing those kind of plays. He's got great springs and great body control, and he's a two-foot jumper, which leads to a lot of fouls, and he's really talented around the rim. So a lot of credit there to Tab in transition, which is where he makes his bread and butter. And all of a sudden, because the made baskets by A&M now, or by Tulane, A&M's now going man. First man possession, they tight curl, get it right to the rim and foul. I don't know if A&M will stick with the man that much because, you know, they certainly shot him out of it with the threes, but that kind of a high-quality drive by Morgan is just too easy.
So Morgan at the line. And he gets...
Hey, it rolled in. What a difference a half will make. I mean, they got 44 right now in the first half. I don't know if they were going to have 44 if we went to six overtimes at that rate, but they got it going a little bit here.
They had 19 at the half. And here they have 44 just 9 minutes into the second half.
It's amazing. You look a whole lot different when it actually goes in. Now we get it inside to Giroux, and he makes another nice move. West getting his third foul has changed the interior defense for A&M. He shot challenged and had a couple blocks early. Total momentum of the game has changed at this point. You know, A&M Coach Hayes is probably going to try to get it back to West. He hasn't had a touch in a while. Or there's another good option with Tab, but that's probably what we were looking for right on cue. And a good shot, just didn't go. You're going to get another foul and a block out. That's the seventh one. I mean, we're heading for a world record of fouls on defensive blockouts right now with Tulane. I mean, this shot goes up by West. Good effort by Giroux. Terrific out of – and it goes up, and you see he's rooting back as he's in the air. I mean, that's a foul. It's a tough call, and it's a frustrating call if you're a Tulane fan. But that's a call that's going to get made. Once the guy's in the air, you can't be backing into him. For Kane, Kane needs to get his hands up, show his hands, back into him, and he's got to get off the ground and go compete for the ball. You can't just hold your block out, you know, like you can at the lower levels, because you can hold your block out forever. At this level, guys are too big, too athletic. They're making a play on the ball, and most of the best rebounders in the country don't block out. They go chase it and get it.
Tab with 14. Converts.
Yeah, and this is a guy who had 100 offensive rebounds last year, like we talked at the start of the broadcast. I mean, that's an insane number for a perimeter guy to have almost 100 offensive rebounds. And tonight he's going to end up with his average or more. I mean, he's got three or four already.
Something pretty odd last year. Tab led the league in scoring and rebounding and was not the player of the year and was second team all conference. How does that happen?
I don't know. That's crazy. And, you know, Texas Southern had a really good year, and so maybe that's the way it went, but close to an illegal screen there that they passed on.
And see, Harris is fouled.
That's where Harris is really good. Now, he's made his jumpers, but I'm telling you, he's got very polished footwork. And then you watch him on his catches. Everything squared up, very mechanical. Got a good tight shot fake. Let the guy get into his body, and you get to go to the line for an easy one-on-one right here, which, you know, you still got to convert the free throws. But good offensive players, just basic footwork. Catches it on jump stop, shows a ball fake, and accepts the contact. You know, most freshmen don't have the physicality that Harris has. He's a big, strong kid who's really got some good polish to his game offensively.
Harris converts, 16 points, 5 rebounds, 4 assists a game a year ago up in Chicago.
Yeah, he played at Morgan Park as a junior. They won a state championship. He transferred to St. Rita, had a great year and a great program. Has produced a ton of Division I players as well. And Morgan Park's a storied team in the state. Coach Nick Irvin does a great job. He's been coached and knows how to play. And, you know, he'll need to continue to develop on the defensive end. Looks like Tulane went back zone here with the 1-3-1. I like this. They got the lead, and did a good job here showing him. And ball getting reversed against the zone.
You saw that graphic. Tulane has outscored Alabama A&M 29-19.
Yeah, nice run for him offensively. And the defensive energy's really picked up. Great effort play.
How about that? You block a three, it ends in the right hands, and a huge three for A&M.
It bounced to the wrong guy. The last place you wanted that going was Tab, the preseason player of the year. You want that thing kicking to anybody in the world else. Sometimes, you know, like we said about embracing the struggle, it's been that type of game. Like, you make two great effort plays defensively, you get the block, and the ball just goes right to him. Here you see Kane Harris, terrific legal block, doesn't foul, and it goes anywhere else on the court. It's a shot clock violation. You know, that's one of those that just in the end, you just shake your head when you're coaching. And when you're playing, you love to see those things happen where you're in a position. I'm telling you, there's no better feeling in the world than having the ball hit your hands with two or three on the shot clock.
And the confidence when that ball lands as the shot clock was expiring. And I think he just got it off. I think they're going to look at that.
Yeah, they may be looking to see if it was a two or a three or even if it was good by the shot clock because it was a corner jumper, which is going to be tight because the three-point line's tight to a sideline there more so than anywhere else on the floor. And then you also have the shot clock implication of if, you know, with a block shot, sometimes the shot clock operator can hit that button and you get that automatic reset. Because, you know, it wasn't a deal where we heard the horn going off. And
I didn't
everything.
Hear the horn. I thought he released it just before.
Yeah, I did too. I thought it was good and going to count. And, you know, like we said, wrong guy if you're a Tulane fan. If you're an Alabama A&M fan, you're loving it. You wanted it going to Tab or West. Tab has made his presence felt in this basketball game. After that slow start, he got himself in transition, got some easy opportunities, drew some fouls, had the offensive rebound put back, which was just a terrific athletic play. And all of a sudden now he's getting some jumpers to go and got himself in the post for the easy and one. And West has been solid all night. You know, the thing is, you knew those two guys would be great.
Here's the instant replay. Let's take a look. Yeah, couple of things. One, was it a three? And two, did he get the shot off in time?
Yeah, here Harris does a good job recognizing and getting out to the shooter and a great shot block, and that is a three, and that's good.
That's good.
They can look at that one for a week. Sometimes it confuses me the officials go to the monitor. Like, we just looked at that. That takes us less than 2 seconds. That's not even in debate. They'll study that thing from 12 angles and look at it for a half hour and then come out and go, oh, it's good. Like, you really think it was a, what do you got? It looks like a Matlock moment of the night. And, I mean, you could have had that one in 2 seconds.
I mean, he did just get it off.
I'm not saying it wasn't close, but that angle, that's not very tricky.
Once you saw it one time, you're like, oh, that's good.
Yeah, it's good, and we can keep going.
What a play for Tab, who now has 18 to lead all scorers in this.
Yeah, I think his preseason player of the year may turn to postseason. He keeps this kind of performance going. We got 10 minutes left. He's been on pace for 25 or 30.
Big rebound there for A.J. Wade.
Seeing a little man-to-man by Tulane. It's really increased the flow of the game this man both teams have showed. That's okay. See, they got West. They made him relocate on the shot fake, so it wasn't an in-rhythm jumper. See, a long challenge three there, and it's missed. You know, the type of shots they're giving up now is much different than what they were maybe giving up earlier on some of those where they were lost in conversion and not guarding the right guy. And there's that hands-on in the post. You know, you just can't do it. It's been an emphasis for about 3 or 4 years now. When that guy catches it, you can wall up and chest him, and now they're going to let you forearm bar him. But you see that hand's just on there, and he's got that hand on there forever, and you can't do that. It's the same rule on the perimeter with a hand check.
Talk about a tale of two halves. Tulane shot 21% in the first half, 62 here in the second half.
Hey, man, don't call the administration and tell them to buy a new basket. That's all I can come up with. Buy a new basket. Maybe it's a hoop at that end that's the problem because it's the same guy shooting the same ball it's going in. Maybe we need to come up with a donor for a new hoop because that one didn't look too good at the other end. Nerves are a funny thing, and so is pressure when you come out in that first game with a lot of new guys.
It was 27, not 21, but still a huge difference.
Night and day. There's been more action in the last 2 minutes than we probably had in the entire first half. Both teams going at it right here.
Here's Perry. Bounce pass into the corner and another whistle.
Yeah, I think what he called there, if you run out of bounds and come in and you're the first player to touch, that's illegal. They call that if you intentionally run out of bounds. It's just a turnover. It's not an illegal straight, not a foul. Just you're not able to do that. Unfortunate Morgan there coughing it up. That's leading the break, so this will be something. My man, how about left-handed? Takes that contact. That looks so easy. And I'm going to tell you right now that there's 24 Division I players in here today, and there aren't three doing that, making it look that easy. There may not be two.
Well, he was quiet a little early, but man, has he made an impression.
Yeah, he sure has. And here he's playing good. I'm killing you on offense, defense. And what I mean by that is he's got it really cooking on offense. He is under no terms going to foul. He had his hand straight up and was retreating the entire way. Like, I can't foul myself out of the game. If this guy scores, I'll go get us a basket at the other end.
A.J. Wade tied that one up. Alternating possession arrow. Back to Tulane.
Good screen. The screener actually got a curl and good shot. I think Morgan, as he makes plays instinctively off the catch, is very impactful for this Tulane team. And here we don't know who we're guarding in Tulane in transition, and A&M makes them pay. I'm telling you, every time they've made a mental mistake, this veteran A&M team has punished them. Give Coach Hayes and his crew a lot of credit. They've really answered the bell on big possessions.
Second big three for A.J. Wade.
Little high ball screen. They go under, and Morgan gets it to the rim. And you got a jump stop right there. Got a jump stop when you pass. Can't go off 1 foot, and I know I've brought that up several times, but one-foot jumpers tend to avoid traffic and get offensive fouls. And here
shots
it is.
Starting to fall. These teams playing really well. We got ourselves a ball game. 53-52.
Thank you.
.50 remaining in this one. Tulane and Alabama A&M. Green Wave leading it by one.
Well, you got A&M, Tab and West, 20 and 11 respectively, so 31 of the 52 points. You know, that's where the ball's going to go through for A&M in this next 8 minutes, especially these 8 minutes at crunch time. Tulane's going to have to make sure they get those guys stopped.
Alabama A&M, Jacob Perry back outside, shot no good, and another foul going on the rebound.
Yeah, I'm telling you, I don't know the world record for this in terms of fouls called on blockouts, but we got to be close. I mean, we are, I believe, at 8 on Tulane for the game, if I haven't lost track. It's a deal where they're holding their blockouts possibly a little too long, and the officials feel like they're holding, so you got to make an adjustment. Even if you think it's not the right call as a player and you don't like the call, at some point, veteran players have to be smart enough to realize to change it, and there's the problem because they don't have veteran guys. They've got new guys, but at some point, they got to make an adjustment because they're just shooting themselves in the foot. And again, it's Tab. That's not an offensive rebound on the stat sheet, but it's 2 points because of his ability to offensive rebound.
Now, we talked about rule changes. That's not a rule change. Is this something they're emphasizing?
I don't know. I haven't seen that called. You know, it's obviously early in the year. I think this is more than we'll typically see, and I think it's just the Tulane guys need to make a little adjustment. Great shot fake inside. Really good move. I mean, I can't tell you how impressed I've been with Dylan tonight. I mean, around the rim right there in the high post. And that's a big possession. You're trailing at home under eight minutes. I mean, you need to make plays. That was a very, very polished move in the post.
11 points, 9 boards for Osetkowski. Closing in on a double-double. There's West, and he gets in there and out. Very nice move.
Yeah, that's big time right there. That is, we call that just better offense. That's I'm better than you type of move, basically. Like, that's just terrific. That's one-on-one isolation basketball. Guy spins up through traffic and scores it. See, this is where I think they're really smart right now, Tulane, because they have got to jam it inside when they can, because fouls on West and Tab, which are the two guys guarding the 4 and 5, that's the two guys that are owning you on the other end. So if you can find a way to get them out of the game, it would drastically change things, but they just haven't been able to generate enough fouls on those guys to make that a factor. They've been in the whole time other than West briefly in the first half.
Both guys do have three here with 6:39 to go, but if you get that key four here, especially with 6-plus to go, they're going to the bench.
I know this. Alabama A&M's had a terrific game plan and been very, very good tonight. If both those guys were to foul out, this game would look a lot different, because you just are talking about two first-team All-League players. Nobody can replace that. I don't care what league in the country you're talking about.
Now Tulane with a little foul trouble. Dabney and Morgan both with four.
And here we go in conversion. Not matched up again. Leads to an easy shot. Great rebound. I mean, that's a man rebound in traffic right there. But you can't give that shot up not knowing who you're guarding.
Underneath for Giroux, and another foul.
Yeah, you know what? It's kind of interesting, and it's early season is the issue. And as a fan, you know, you come to these games. Here you see the high-low pass. Really, really good look. Osterhaus has just been terrific. I mean, he gets that thing in the high post. He has been a machine in terms of dumping high-low. He's made two jumpers. I kind of feel like he probably needs to. He's in that mode where I'm a sophomore. I played some last year. Now I have a bigger role. You got to embrace the bigger role a little bit and say, hey, you know what, this team's counting on me to provide some offensive punch. He can really make some things happen for this team. And Dabney's back in, which should help Tulane right here down the stretch. Hopefully he's not stiff, but he's been sitting over there for a long time.
Second free throw for Giroux, and Tulane is up by a bucket.
Big possession here for A&M. They need to continue to score and put points on the board. Interesting here, milking the clock and shortening the game. Not a bad idea, to be honest. And here you got the ball and your two best players up top. A little screen to screen are going to stagger it up from the top and look in the post to West.
In the corner. Dribble drive by Battle. Kicks it back out. Long shot, no good. Rebound, Morgan.
But see, Morgan pursued the ball. He wasn't enamored with the block out. He wasn't, trying to keep the Alabama A&M player from the ball. He was trying to go get the ball, and that's why it wasn't a foul on him, and that's the adjustment the Tulane guys got to make. Here you go, high-low, and you get another foul. That's what I'm telling you. I mean, this is going to change the entire flow of the game if they can high-low them when they're playing man. That's four right there, I believe.
Yep.
And I mean, you're talking about a guy who has been at times the best player on the floor today, and certainly has been a big, big factor, in deciding who's got the lead or down. 2-point ball game, 5 minutes, a long time to play with four fouls.
And Coach Hayes, I think, sticking with them.
I think it's smart. I mean, you know what? Right now, if this free throw goes in by Giroux, who's been terrific tonight at the foul line, if he makes another one, all of a sudden you're down four. You take him out, this thing could get
to
seven or eight, and it's done.
So you might as well stick with him.
Listen, I like it. He's rolling the dice right now. Sometimes you got to have some courage in coaching. And, listen, he's done a great job tonight giving his team a chance to win. They got to be really happy with what's happened to this point. You don't want to get on the bus and him have four fouls in this game. Changed with you having him out. Another little UCLA screen going to look in the post, but basically it's a pick and pop. Boy, needed to throw that thing back quicker.
Perry over to West, and a foul on Giroux.
He's really polished as an offensive guy for that size. He's so comfortable facing up. The pick and pop, he was open had they got it a half a second earlier. But what a good shot fake. I mean, you're going to watch basketball all year doing these games, and you're not going to see a lot of 6'9 guys that have the ability to shoot from three, from 15 feet, and also shot fake and straight line drive it like he can. And really, really good players had a big impact on the game for A&M. West does. He needs to make these free throws because this late in the game, it's only one free throw, but boy, they just loom large at this time.
Converts one of two, but hey, he has really been an exciting player, the way he moves. And
yeah, he's fun to watch. This A&M team's got some guys. I'll tell you what, they were picked fourth in the SWAC. I'd like to see who was picked third because they're awfully good. I mean, they have two terrific players.
They really do.
Terrific players. And then they've got some nice complimentary veteran pieces, guys that are very capable. And you saw in the first half when B.J. Houston came in and banged two shots. That's who really got them going and got them the lead. So they've got places to turn. Another nice pass.
Shot for three, no good. Ozenkowski with a big board and a follow.
My man's been MVP down the stretch. He's really been big for them with the, another just effort play. And I'll tell you what, his rebounds don't occur below the rim. He's an explosive athlete. He's going to get that thing at 11, 12 feet. He's going to have to get comfortable that he's got a bigger role now than what he had in the past.
Works it around here. Jacob Perry. Ozenkowski guarding him way out there. Shot no good. Rebound West. Nick West underneath the goal.
Unbelievable. What a finish. I mean, that is such a terrific, terrific play. The big fella goes and gets it with two hands in traffic at about 11 feet above the rim, comes down, lands on balance, power dribble, goes to the other side and uses the rim to protect. Good shot by Tab on this pick and pop. This is just terrific. He out-toughs Duro for the rebound, power dribble, and can take that contact, which good job by not fouling, but that could be called. There's some contact there. That's a really hard finish right there and a terrific play. I mean, I can't go on about West, how impressive he's been in this ballgame.
Yeah, because if he goes up, Ozenkowski could have blocked it, but he went the other way.
Yeah, used the rim to protect it. And that's the thing about veteran guys. And you know what? It's not true of all veteran guys because bad players that are seniors are bad players. That veteran stuff's out the window. Good players who develop and become seniors all of a sudden, like West, I mean, this guy, he uses angles, he steps out on the perimeter, he beats you with shot fakes, he beats you with his touch, he gets fouled, he makes free throws, he can offensive rebound, he's a catch drop off guy, and the hard thing is, realize he's a five man, how few times he's been on the block. Coach Hayes has really moved him around a lot in this ball game. He's used him inside and outside. And it's the hardest thing to guard is a post guy who can step to the three-point line.
Those two guys have really made an impact. West, 16 points, 7 boards. Ladarius Tab, 22 points, 7 boards.
Yeah, it's no mystery who's going to continue to touch the ball every possession the last 4 minutes, which is why I'm going back to, Tulane right here. If there's some way you can jam it inside, because West has three and is trying not to foul, and Tab has four and can't foul. So, at this point in the game, you just got to try to attack those guys. And, we've had some success as far as Tulane getting it in there, but A&M has offset that on the other end by drawing the bigs out to the perimeter.
Here's Morgan, brings it across midcourt.
And here's the zone. This is really an interesting ploy because, they were zone and it really stagnated them. And then the threes by Harris got them out of the zone. And here's a turnover back in the zone. Transition, if he pitched that back.
Battle's shot gets blocked.
I'll tell you what, Battle's a really good point guard. He averaged almost 6 assists a game last year. If he pitches that thing back to Tab, it's a dunk. He probably, if he had it to do over again, would have seen that play and pitched it. That was unfortunate for A&M because that was an easy opportunity.
Working it around here for Jacob Perry, and now back atop for Battle.
The under four time of the game, you got to get it to your main guys. No mystery for who that is with A&M at all. And for Tulane, it'll be interesting. Oh, wow, uncontested.
Battle from way out there, and it's drained.
That's called courage and, being an upper-class guy who's played a lot. He's only a junior, with this team having 8 seniors. That's a big-time courage shot right there.
That's his first points of the night.
Yeah, well, he tried to get that one in transition. He didn't like me telling him he should have kicked it back to Tab for the dunk. He said, I'll just go in for three. That almost a steal. You gamble, you give up. And I tell you what, I didn't know if that was going to go in or not. It's amazing. Both those balls, I mean, you're almost speechless watching them. I mean, the amount of times that Tulane has had a ball rattle and not go in would only rival the amount of fouls on defensive blockouts. That's the only two numbers I can think of that would be close to that high.
Enormous numbers here tonight.
Listen, I was a state school guy, man. I couldn't count that much, so I don't even know how many of those we've had. I know it's eight fouls on blockouts, but the rattleouts in this game for Tulane have been many. And Alabama A&M's patience and poise, and you just love battle right there because he makes it. He jumps up and he's got toughness and courage that I haven't been a big part of the offense. I've been he is a big part because he runs the show, but not a big part in terms of attempts, and he had the toughness to jump up and knock that in.
Here's Ryan Smith, converted on the first two free throws back in the first half, misses here. He's got 4 points to go along with 5 rebounds today.
Well, the tightness for Tulane, what happened because of the inexperience, early they were tight and they didn't get off to a very good start. And then they kind of loosened up and got going, but now it's winning time and you can almost feel like the nerves have crept back in with this young team. And it's really, I think Dabney's going to have to make a big play for him. And you can't say enough about Ostakowski, because I think if they can get it to him, he can make a good winning play also. And other guys are capable, but it's just not been coming as easy for some others tonight.
Here's Battle. 5 on the shot clock. West from 3 buries it.
That's really a tough defensive play for Smith right there. He didn't get out on West. He hung in the post too long because you're not used to guarding a 5-man out at the 3-point line. But, I mean, you got to make the adjustment. He's way too good of a shooter to be late on a closeout like he was right there.
His second 3 he's drained here tonight. Dabney sets, shoots, and fires. No good. Battle for the loose ball, and we got a whistle.
Great effort play. I don't know if it's not under 2 minutes, so they can't look at it. Kyle Ingram coming in to see and make sure, and I actually don't know, who it's out off of, because that's one of those, everyone's there, but I'm pretty sure that Kyle had that right. That definitely looked like it was Tulane's ball. And, here you see it. We got the advantage of replay. Shot goes up, and there's a lot of bodies right here, and it looks like right there is West right-handed. Definitely, 100%, yeah. Kyle Ingram right on the call. And that's a big one because it saves a possession. Going back a possession where West is able to just run to the 3-point line. It wasn't a set play. It wasn't an anything. He was just hanging around in the paint and sprinting to the top of the key. And unfortunately for Tulane, Smith just was slow getting to him because, back, we talked about it all game, 5 men are used to guarding on the block, not used to guarding behind the 3-point line. And when that thing gets to the 3-point line right there, all of a sudden the guy who's made shots all games at the top of the key, which everyone who's ever played knows, that's the 3-pointer that's the easiest to make of all of them. Wing, corner, top of the key, that's where you want to be. And here it is, he just runs to the top. I mean, I don't know, you got to be there about 2 seconds. The shot clock's at 3, you got to be there way earlier. Big out of bounds right here. I bet they'll go to their X action with these.
Big possession here.
Dove Giroux threw it in long, so we'll see what they run. This zone, again, it's just kind of bottomed them up. Harris is back in, who's made shots. Great
Morgan.
Look. Wide open. I mean, it's a great shot. Just got to make it. Good look. Good possession. But at this point in the game, 2 minutes, great possessions that are empty don't solve anything. You got to get it in the basket.
A&M on an 8-0 run here, looking to add to it.
I would think if anyone other than Tab or West get the ball here for a shot, it would be because the other guy was double-teamed and it got kicked out. I mean, I just got it. There you go. You get it.
Battle
to the big fella. Almost a turnover.
3 shot on the shot clock. Battle will take the 3. Forced it, and it sails out of bounds.
Great, great no-call. Too many times in these games when the clock gets down like that, there might have been a little contact here, but a great shot contest. He kicked his right foot out and kind of initiated the contact. That's a terrific job of officiating right there by Kyle Ingram, who passed on the play, because you call a foul there, it almost decides the game. Because
it was an out-of-control shot. I like the call.
Yeah, you shouldn't reward that, I don't think. And the only time I'd think it is if I was the head coach at Alabama A&M. Then I think for sure you should call that.
How did you miss that?
Yeah. Really good play here by Morgan, driving that zone, which we talked about earlier, and they're able to dump it down and they get a foul on the pass. Two big free throws right here for Tulane. Need to get them in and just keep this game as tight as you can, because right now points are of the essence.
So Morgan, you're down by three. There's a buck 22 to go. You got to make these free throws.
Yeah, because here's the other thing. If he can make this one, they're going to pick up full, I would imagine, and try to do some type of press. And it may not generate a turnover, but what it's going to do is it's going to shorten the shot clock for A&M, which will make it, Tulane to have a better chance to get a stop if they're able to shorten the clock. So it's big he makes that one in here, just as expected. They pick up. It's a little token, though. I'm kind of surprised that Morgan's not up in the ball a little bit more. Got to have a stop here. Thumb up, probably looking at some kind of diagonal, and then a screen to screener. Absolutely diagonal. Going to screen the guy, shoot her up to the top. Going to reverse it, illegal screen. Yeah. You know what? That's a great call. Kids just, little things make the difference between winning and losing. Tab has been outstanding. I mean, terrific tonight. And they ran the diagonal screen to screener, which is exactly what we expected them to run. They run it, and you're going to see Tab right here when he's going running through the lane to set the screen. He's not set. He didn't jump stop and get a good position to set for the screen, and now that's five fouls for him. And if you're Alabama A&M, you better find a way to win this game in regulation, because you don't want to play five-minute overtime with him out.
That's a huge loss. Tulane down by two.
Oh, my.
Just turned it over with 55 seconds to go.
Yeah, Ostrakowski was kind of open on the baseline. Giroux anticipated it, and then the defense did a great job rotating in that 2-3 zone. And now you're in a spot where you got to have a stop. And no five-second call, which we talked about. So he can just dribble the ball here the entire shot clock out, which he did. That would have had a five-second call on a year ago, and he can't do that. But now you can.
Seven on the shot clock. Pick set by West. Battle. Drive. Shot from the corner. Big shot. No good. Offense. No. Rebound. Tulane.
Well, and now comes a big possession for Tulane, and they're going to go ahead and push it. I think they may call timeout, try to get something set up, and maybe not. They're going to let him play a little bit. Oh, you know, and that's I actually, did he call a foul right here? I thought he maybe called, yeah, he called timeout. I'm sorry. Which is what I thought had happened, but then the way they were pointing, I thought they'd called a hand check. So, in these situations late game, I think what Coach Conroy did there is really smart. He let them push to see if they could get an easy one, okay? And when they didn't really have anything developing, then take the timeout versus automatically timeout, because you might get a cheap one where they're not mashed up. Now, A&M, who's done a really nice job defensively the whole game, got back, got mashed up, and they had the ball. White's out of timeout, so they won't have any more left. And there's the timeout rule where you got one less timeout, so that was their last one, which is probably another reason why Coach Conroy didn't call it immediately. So now this 5 seconds underneath, I think A&M will be in zone, which they've been the whole game. However, if you give up a three, you lose. And I'll be honest, if I'm Tulane, I'm happy to get it inside and get a two, because if we can go play five more minutes
with Tab out and West in foul trouble, you
certainly like your chances. And A&M, because they don't want to give up a three, looks like they're going man on this under out, which they haven't done a lot. So maybe Tulane can get a cheap one here just because they don't play a lot of man on these under outs.
Hits it in. Dabney drives, shot, yeah. And he's fouled.
See, Dabney is so good in traffic at going off of 2 feet. And I think that's something that, like, as the younger Frazier learns, that's a great move. It's a man move. You're going to get fouled. It's off 2 feet. It's strong. It's low. It's powerful. And Dabney is initiating contact there, but the defense is moving and not in legal guarding position. So you can initiate contact and get rewarded with the foul. Two biggest free throws of the night right here. So if these go in, we got a tie game, and A&M can hold it for the win.
First free throw attempts of the night. A very good free throw shooter.
Yeah, and listen, the bottom line is percentages are out the window with 12 seconds. This is about your veteran guys having toughness and courage to jump up and make big shots. That's the guy they wanted on the foul line, regardless of someone else. Tulane got to have a stop here. A&M's going to probably pick and pop up at the top.
6 seconds.
Exactly what they ran.
West, ball stripped. Dabney's going to have a chance to win it. The shot is off.
He didn't get it
off. And it is no good.
Yeah, didn't get it off. But you know what? If you're Tulane, this is the amazing thing about basketball. The whole game's gone on. It's been a battle, and probably A&M's controlled most of the action. But now you get it to overtime with a great stop, great defensive help right there by Morgan. Gets a deflection, And you don't score in transition, but it's okay because now you got 5 minutes to play and they don't have Tab, which they're a different team without him.
So he did not get the shot off, by the way, if you were wondering, as we take a look at the replay. So we'll take a timeout. Overtime coming up from Devlin Fieldhouse. We got a good one here in New Orleans.
What happened?
He's blaming you. It's supposed to be a 30-point blow-up.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what. If you watched practice, you'd have thought it too. But what happened is all these freshmen for Tulane got a little tight, and it hadn't happened that way. Good thing you didn't go to Vegas with me, brother.
Regulation is complete. We got nowhere to go. We're going to overtime.
Hey, man, these guys have been wanting to play all year. All those practices, summer workouts, fall workouts, inter-squad scrimmages. They're so excited to play someone else, they decided 40 minutes wasn't enough. Let's do five more.
Throw another five up there. Both teams get an additional timeout, so both teams have two timeouts as we head to overtime.
Yeah, what the official had said was that number zero on White called timeouts because one of our rule changes was you can't call a live ball timeout as a coach. So it wasn't Coach Conroy's timeout. It was Dabney had called it, and I actually misread the signal. I thought he said they were out of timeouts, but he said zero had called it. Travel inside. You know, that's a footwork thing. When you catch it, you got to catch it on a jump stop because when you catch it quick and try to rip, when you fake with that right foot and then lead with the left, it's a travel, and the officials are really good at picking up on that stuff. And it didn't really gain them any advantage. It just resulted in a turnover.
Battle dishes it off to Jacob Perry.
You're seeing a lot of five-out dribble drive. Well, Jerome, what an effort play to come back in, and here you get a transition the other way. And that's the guy going to the rim. That's an and-one. Two-foot jumpers in traffic. He's strong. He's tough. He's got ability to finish. And a rare, again, where A&M this time, because it was Tulane the whole first half. West gets it inside, blocked by Giroux. It leads to transition the other way. In the first half, it was the opposite. It was Tulane missing easy ones and runouts the other way. And another four-point turnaround and a potential five-point turnaround if this goes in. It's two, West doesn't get three Dabney. Well, two Dabney does. So it's still a four-point turnaround, four-point swing.
See who steps up. Obviously, West is their go-to guy now that Tab is gone.
Yeah, and you know, it's easier when you're Tulane to guard one dominant scorer and try to limit his touches. Have you noticed it's been harder for West to get the ball in his hands because they don't have two guys that they're trying to take away? These are tough possessions for A&M right now, and I think you're going to have to see somebody step up and make a big shot, kind of like Battle did earlier and tried to right there. Giroux's been big in overtime, interior defense.
Oh, Dabney saved that one. That nearly was an unforced turnover.
Yeah, that would have been really tough to take because they've got a chance to get a two-possession lead, which I don't think they've done all game, and maybe get a little breathing room. It's just been so tight, nip and tuck the whole way. Sending some ball screen stuff, goes into Giroux, looks high-low. They get it in.
Three on the shot clock. Turnaround for Osetkowski out of bounds. But Tulane will have just one on the shot clock.
Yeah, you can look for some kind of lob play right here. You know what? Here comes Frazier. The lob, I wouldn't be shocked if it's to him because he's got all kinds of bounce. But, you know, it's going to be zone potentially, and if it's zone, it's harder to lob against. I just don't know what A&M's going to do because they've mostly been zoned. This time they're man, and you can tell they're man, and it's going to be a lot easier to get a lob against a man underneath than it is zone. Looks like we got a timeout right here on the floor.
I would assume it's by Tulane. It didn't see, so we will take a break. Tulane with a two-point advantage. 3:20 left in OT. Tulane by two.
I would look for Frazier right here to curl and look for a lob. Morgan may be coming down to screen him. Jerome may be popping to the corner.
We got 1 second on the shot clock. There it is, Frazier.
Oh, he got
time to jump. He didn't have time to catch it. He's got to tip it.
He kind of fumbled it, but, man, that play could not have been executed any better than it was. And all of a sudden, he just wasn't quite a clean catch, but you just got to tip it towards the rim. I think he just kind of bobbled the catch. But, I mean, that you can't get better than that with 1 second. That's tough.
It was a little high.
It was a little high, but you just got to bat that one left-handed and try to tip it in because if you miss, Dabney's right there, offensive rebound.
That's where the volleyball skills come into count.
Yeah, little diagonal action, ball reversal, going to look in the post and probably look to West on some type of reversal because that's where the ball needs to get right now for A&M.
So, battle. It over to Perry, the senior. Christopher Perry drives, shot short, no good.
Got a clean block right there. Very fortunate if you're Tulane that you got ball and didn't get called for a foul because that looked like a really good drive and a close call on the baseline.
Seventh block of the day for Tulane. Osetkowski couldn't finish.
Yeah, good move. You know, the only thing I didn't like about it, nobody on the offensive glass, and it was kind of a weird possession, just the footwork of it. There goes West again, going back to the foul line. Big fella up top is a problem. When he catches it and can straight line drive you, and majority of his drives have been right, where he's gotten fouled, here shows the ball, puts it down right-handed. Good job by Morgan trying to get in there and dig, but the problem is West has beaten Giroux by a step, so it's hard to help when the guy's beaten by a step. You got to be able to angle him a little bit, and this is a big foul right here. In terms of fouling out with Giroux because he's really given him a lot of good life and been a factor on the offensive glass, scoring in the post at times, and blocked two shots. And has really been the best matchup for West on a night where I'm not sure anybody's matched up real well with him.
16.7 boards as Giroux fouls out.
Yeah, he had a really good game. And, you know, fortunate to get a miss right there. A&M's got to feel pretty good, though. You know, you got it to a two-minute game. Really impressed with just the toughness that they've showed on the road. First games are always tough, but they've given themselves a lot of chances to win.
Makes one of two. 20 points on the night for West.
Oh, it could be a turnover.
Turnover. Got Jacob Perry.
Got cute with the ball, got a little careless. Speaking of careless. no-look pass with 2 minutes to go in overtime. Coach going to need some stomach medicine, some Maalox, man, if they keep doing the no-look passes with 2 minutes. I don't know what's going on. Got to have some fundamentals, big fella.
Had the turnover in the backcourt and then almost turned it right back over. Here's Battle. Five on the shot clock. Drive, shot, off the iron, no good. Osetkowski, lead pass to Frazier, and they turn it over. Little too fast pace.
Just not being veteran. It's just a minute to go, and you need to have somebody kind of huddle them up and make sure guys understand, because the guys on the floor, you know, it looks great to get a transition basket, but boy, to turn that over, they've had two straight where you just need a shot if you're Tulane. Another diagonal screen, go right into West, and he turns it over. This has become, I'm not sure
here.
I want to win. I'm not sure you want to win. I don't know. They're really, you know, guys playing hard and selling out, but fundamental habits late will get you beat. I mean, both teams been a little guilty, but boy, oh boy, you just cannot have turnovers with 2 minutes to go in an overtime game.
Dabney wide open, couldn't drain the three.
Well, here comes Perry, and he's a capable offensive guy. Coach really is excited about what he brings to the table. He hadn't quite got on track yet. Maybe he can give him an option, because I just think it's going to be hard for West if he's – and any time they diagonal screen and got him in tight spaces with Tab fouled out, he hasn't been able to kind of shake loose. His shake loose plays have been up top on pick and pop, on isolation, top of the key or high wing area, because when he gets down in that post – it's easier for Tulane to shrink the floor and send bodies at him, and that's what happened on the turnover when they flicked it away with Osterhowski being able to get it away from him. And I think that as the game wears on, you know that West has to be the guy. They're going to need to keep him in the middle of the floor for him to be able to not have to be double-teamed.
It's a one-point ball game, a minute two left. Both teams have a timeout in their back pocket.
Yeah, and that could come into play. And the interesting thing, which happened at the end of regulation, coaches can't call timeouts. It was the one where I misread the official signal. Right now, players have to be very in tune, and it's a little scary. You know, Coach Conroy's got a new point guard out there, and, you know, Malik Morgan, very talented, good player, but he's played some two, he's played some one, and right now he's got to play like the quarterback, the point guard, and he had that turnover in the open floor just against token pressure where he tried to inside out cross a guy 90 feet from the basket when that's the last thing you want to be doing. You know, you don't want to take any chances when they had the lead and the ball. We need a shot. He just hasn't had that feel yet, which hopefully will come for him as the season wears.
Tremendous defensive play by Jacob Perry, who will inbound here.
Yeah, he's strong and he's quick and he's low to the ground and got really good feet and stayed right in front and capitalized. Here, I want, you know, Battles, the guy made that huge three for him. Maybe he can get him going. Set play, going to look back inside here possibly on a curl, but they're going to go into West.
Over to Thomas, now to West.
And there comes the double team, which we talked about, like when you get them on the block, but boy, they got it out of the double team. What are we going to call? And one?
Zachary Jackson, is it offensive?
They can't. The basket's waved off. That's the new rule change. That play was like that forever. But the new rule, if they call charge, the basket is wiped off.
Basket does not count.
And the ball was clearly gone. You can see the ball's gone. That's a basket. And, I mean, you talk about the rule changes having an effect. Mike in the truck, like, got playing out to a cue. He put the rule changes up for everybody, and it's going to possibly decide the game on a rule change right there. Because that, in the past, is a basket for A&M, and then it would go to the other end for a one-and-one. Where you can cancel it out and get the lead back if you're Tulane. But now A&M's down one, and you wipe away the basket, and they're on defense with 45 seconds to go. Don't have to foul here. Can just play for a stop. But, boy, this is a tough stretch of the game.
Huge play. So 45 seconds left. Tulane by a point and the ball. Obviously, the difference in the shot clock, about 15 seconds.
Yeah, I think right here you're going to see A&M just kind of be patient and try to play for a stop, which is smart. And the only thing that can kill them right now is a three, because a three makes it a two-possession game. So you got to get to shooters where even if they're able to get a two, that's the thing you don't want to have happen. He missed it. But, boy, if that goes in, you just lost. So, you know, fortunate that it rattled out.
Huge rebound by West, who has had such a big game. What do you expect from Nick West?
I'm expecting an isolation play right here, and Perry's going to go one-on-one is what I think they're going to do. And it's exactly what he did.
Shot good.
up by one. 2 seconds to go. Daphne with a desperation effort. Short.
What a move by Perry. I thought they may, you know, coach was high on him coming in. He can beat guys off the dribble, and that's exactly what we saw. He just flattened the defense out. He went one-on-one. He made the inside-out move, and in that situation, when you're Tulane, you're trying so hard not to foul that you kind of avoid the guy, and he slithered in and got an uncontested layup. That's great play by Perry. Unbelievable finish to the game. You know, tough for Tulane to end it on that. What a good move, straight line drive. And there's Giroux fouling out. Instead of him to shot contest and shot block, Smith, who's a very good position defender but doesn't have the same length and explosiveness, isn't able to create the shot block.
Watching that play on replay, I was all ready for him to shoot it out the west.
There was no chance.
He did.
Listen, he's a scorer. And those guys, like when Coach was talking about him, he said he's got a scorer's mentality. And if you think about it, he took some maybe not great shots during the game that were, you know, you watch him and you're like, oh, it might be a little forced or what have you. But he's got so much confidence as a player. He believes he can win. And I'm telling you, in that stage of the game, courage and confidence always overcome statistics. What a great play. What a great move. Unbelievable for A&M way to start their season with a win on the road at Tulane. And this is a Tulane team that's going to get better and better as the year goes on. You know, you're playing without two starters, and you get off to a tough start in the game. I think if the game starts different, it probably ends different, but it didn't. Give A&M all the credit in the world. Great win for them. And, you know, Coach Conroy got a long season ahead of them. They'll keep grinding, and they'll get better and better as it goes on.
Fun way to start the season for Geno Ford. I'm Tim Grubbs. But a lot of fun, partner. We're doing it again. So long from New Orleans. Your final score in overtime. Alabama A&M knocking off Tulane. 68-67. To watch this entire game on replay as well as other games from our family of ESPN networks, log on to watchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN.